Until the early 1800s, commerce on Green River mainly traveled one way, downstream. In 1833, Kentucky authorized development of a slackwater project to improve navigation on the Green and Barren Rivers, extending to Bowling Green. By 1841, four locks and dams were completed on Green River and one on Barren, creating a navigational route between Bowling Green and Evansville, Indiana. Another study of the Upper Green River was authorized in 1890, and the result was the construction of locks and dams numbers 5 and 6. When construction was complete in 1906, the steamboat Chaperone made the first run from Evansville to Mammoth Cave, and traffic on the Green River system was in its heyday. However, by August of 1951, the Army Corps of Engineers ceased operation of Lock 6 due to waning use, and for over 65 years, it has simply sat idle.
Friday after Thanksgiving, at about 11 p.m., we had a stream gauge, USGS did, and we were reading them, and it just, within 2 hours, the whole pool was gone. It came through the hole under the dam.
So that became a safety hazard.
The safety being, if somebody fell in, they'd immediately be drawn in and under. The way you see the water come out, but you don't see anything else come out.
Yeah.
That's because the dam's built on timber piles and it acts like a big sieve. And you'd be pinned against those and that'd be it.
You've been working with this dam and doing this, the impact study and trying to lobby to get this thing taken out for...
Since 1986.
Yeah. We're finally here, we're getting this thing removed. But it really took it being a safety hazard and then it all finally fell into place.
Absolutely.
But it's a coordinated effort with a lot of agencies.
Absolutely. Kentucky Fish and Wildlife, your own is one, certainly. U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, been another really big player. Their, matter of fact, their crew's doing the removal. Mammoth Cave National Park, and then the non-governmental organizations, the Nature Conservancy and the Kentucky Waterways Alliance.
So Lee, you're kind of overseeing this project here.
Yeah, we're heading up the removal of Dam 6 here on the Green River. Mm-hmm. It's a unique project for us in Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't taken a dam out that's this big. We have a crew of folks from several states that work in our fisheries, and we build, you know, waterfowl impoundments and other kind of structures, and so they know how to move material and break things up. And then historically, there's been a big need for removing old dams on rivers. They're obsolete. They, in particular, have affected our fish runs in some rivers.
This whole project's taking place really relatively quickly.
It breached Thanksgiving night. Wasn't too many days after that, we got a call from the Corps of Engineers saying, you know, would you all be willing to come help us take this out? But what, 4.5 months, 5 months later, you know, we got four pieces of equipment in the river, and the dam is being broken down.
This is going to be great for the access for fishermen as well.
That's right, Chad. Well, there's about 14,000 canoes and kayaks that come down the Green River every year, and this dam has always presented somewhat of an obstacle and a hazard. So if we can put in some access over there, then what a great opportunity for those folks.
So really, there's no real negatives. This dam has been here now for over 100 years. The lock on this dam has not been used for over 65 years.
That's right. There's about 87,000 dams on the registry. Over 4,000 of those received a deficient report card from the American Society of Civil Engineers back in 2013. And these dams were built to power the Industrial Revolution. And some of these, like this one, are over 100 years old.
Yeah.
And there's no money to keep them up. They no longer serve their purpose. And what better opportunity for us to provide some access.
You've been actually doing some research on this particular body of water and how the fish relate above and below with the water flowing, right?
We've been looking at the sport fish populations upstream of Mammoth Cave in our unimpounded sections, the free-flowing sections. and we've been comparing that against the sport fish populations down in this pool below the dam that's behind us.
You're walking around here with a big smile on your face today, so I'm guessing that your data is showing you that this fishery is about ready to get better.
What we're seeing is exceptional numbers of our sport fish, the smallmouth bass, spotted bass, rock bass, channel catfish that a lot of our anglers like to catch in the streams, but we don't see them down here in the pooled up sections. I expect this to get tremendously better and see a lot of these smallmouth and rock bass and stuff start migrating down into this area as this river kind of returns back to a river. It's not impounded. We start getting riffles and shoals and get back to that complex habitat that we need for those species.
So we're going to make it a better fishery in the long run, get rid of the barrier of the dam, and then also improve the access to the water.
That's right.
It's a win-win situation.
Well, it makes it so that, you know, you have a good short float. Most people aren't real hardcore about the whole floating thing. You know, they don't want to be out there for 2 weeks or something like that.
And they'd really go downriver if possible.
That's right. They don't want to paddle a whole lot. So this is going to make it great. They can put in at Mammoth Cave, or they can put in, you know, below Nolin Lake, float down, be a, you know, moderate day, you know, 6-8 hours or something like that. Take out, go to Brownsville, get them a cheeseburger and go home.